What really works to avoid scarring after surgery or injury? This video will show you. I'm Dr. Mike Nyack. I'm a facial plastic surgeon from St. Louis, Missouri. And having done this for almost 20 years, I get almost once a week a patient or a perfect stranger or a friend call me in a frenzy after having had surgery, an injury, or something else they're afraid is going to leave a scar. And they want me to give them my best advice as to what can be done to prevent scarring. Well, what I'm going to share with you is what I tell my very best friends and patients when I want them to have the best outcomes possible. So the first thing to know is final scar quality depends on a bunch of items. Two of them are unfortunately out of your control. The particular degree of injury is out of your control. Little minimal injuries are going to leave less of a mark. More significant injuries might leave a little more of a mark, but that's out of your control. The second thing is genetics. Some people's healing is exceptionally good, and no matter what happens, it leaves no marks. Some people, like me and darker skin types, even little things will leave permanent discoloration or little thickened scars. And in that context, it's especially important you do everything you can to optimize healing. Now, with those two parts being said that are out of your control, what is in your control? So immediately at the time of injury, what is in your control is cleaning the wound. So if you have a wound that's full of road debris or animal saliva or dirt, that's going to be very inflammatory. It's going to increase bacterial multiplication. It's going to make the wound angry. Angry wounds make ugly scars. So the first thing for you to do is to wash that wound and get it nice and clean. And in most contexts, just soap and tap water is fine. The second thing that is important when it comes to a wound is you have to realize there is still a thing called tetanus out there. So even though we're really focused on scars, if you haven't had a tetanus shot recently, your local pharmacy can usually do this, your urgent care can do it, your primary care doctor can do it. Make sure you're up to date on your tetanus. Now, you have a clean wound, your tetanus, you've cut that in the back of your mind, you have that under control. What's the next thing to do? Well, the next thing to do, I often get asked, does it need stitches? So if it's very superficial, if it's a scrape, we generally don't put stitches in it. Scrapes means it's not all the way through the body of the skin. It's just like the icing of the cake. It's not down through the actual cake itself. If the wound, if the scratch has gone all the way through, down through the cake itself, so that the actual body of the skin is separating, it needs to be held together to heal really fine. Basically, healing is the top layers of skin are coming together, and they're erasing scar tissue coming up from the bottom. So if those top layers are left gapped, scar tissue will come up from the bottom and you get a wide, ugly scar. So when do you need stitches? You need stitches if the surface of the skin is gapped, and especially if the body of the skin is gapped. Sometimes it's hard to tell, especially if you're a layperson. It might actually require a trip to urgent care just to see that. Now, as far as stitches versus Steri-strips, it's another very common question that we get. Steri-strips or glue do a really nice job of holding the surface together. But if you imagine that cake, the surface can be brought together, but unless the meat, the body of the cake is held together, you can actually have a gap where the bottom is drifting apart while the surface looks like it's together. And it's kind of like having a sheet over two mattresses that have a gap between them. That sheet will drop inwards and it leads it to a depressed scar. So if you have a gap in the skin or a full thickness cut, Steri-strips and Dermabond and glue are not going to be the same as a beautiful layered closure, even though it looks like the surface is together. Now, once you have those stitches in, what do you do to care for it? So you can imagine what happens after the stitches are done, also impacts the final quality of the wound. So the first few days, the wound itself will make what's called an exudate. It will weep a little bit. It's a little bit of dried blood. It's a little bit of serum, maybe a little golden crusting kind of stuff. That scabbiness sits between the two surface edges of the wound. And if that scabbiness is allowed to be there, the skin cells have to grow under it to get to the other side. That leads to a little depression and a wider scar. On the converse, if you dissolve away that scabbiness, and I usually do that with a little bit of peroxide, just plain old pharmacy peroxide, three times a day or so, use a soaked Q-tip, dissolve away, let it bubble away the scabbiness, the crustiness. It keeps those edges together without a gap of scab between it, and it allows the skin cells to migrate very quickly across that gap instead of scar tissue beating them up from the bottom. The other thing that increases the speed of skin cell migration is a moist environment. So I ask my patients, whether it's an intentional incision line or a traumatic incision line, to keep the stitches moist with a non-medicated ointment like Vaniply or Vaseline or Aquaphor several times per day. So I say peroxide to bubble away little scabs first 3 or 4 days. We do the peroxide about 3 times a day. After the peroxide, a nice layer of non-medicated ointment, and anytime it looks dry, a nice layer of non-medicated ointment, Vaniply, Vaseline, Aquaphor, drugstore stuff. We have that ointment go all the way until stitches are removed because we want to keep that wound really moist to allow skin cells to travel. Now, the stitches usually come out on the face 5 to 7 days, on the body 7 to 14 days. As a general rule, the thicker the skin, the longer the stitches need to remain. So on the face, 5 to 7 days is plenty. As you get down to the neck and the body and the arms, it might be 10 to 14 days. Once the stitches are out, you have another opportunity to start modulating and modifying how beautiful and how invisible that scar is going to be. That's where products typically come in. So the wound is closed, the stitches are out, you have a fresh healing incision line. What can you do to improve how quickly that incision line matures and how beautifully it matures? Silicone-based products are the single best thing that you can use. So there's a lot of stuff you can buy at the drugstore, and a lot of it gets marketed really heavily, but it's been shown time and time again in the medical literature that silicone-based products are fantastic. So on the body, under clothes, silicone tapes, silicone sheets work very effectively. On the face, it's hard to put silicone sheets or silicone tapes on the face or around the eyelids. So instead of that, what I strongly recommend is a silicone gel. And I've actually had a silicone gel formulated that I believe the body and the weight is really excellent for facial incision lines. It really helps optimize the healing of the facial incision line. And it's really nice because when you put that on, it dries into a non-tacky, non-shiny layer. And you do it a couple times a day and forget about it. Silicone products in general, we start using after the stitches are out and it's a watertight wound that's usually 7 to 14 days. And I recommend people keep using them until the pinkness has faded. So if you have a fully mature 2-year-old silver white incision line, don't buy the silicone products. It's not going to help. They've already reached their final maturity. On the flip side, if you just had a cesarean section or just had a breast reduction or just had a facial injury and you have a hot, pink, stiff incision line, silicone products are great, used a couple times a day until that pinkness is faded. So once you're at the stage of healing where you're using the scar gel on your incision line, it's usually 1 to 2 weeks after, we put the scar gel on the incision line and that helps modify wound healing, but then we can also protect that further by using sunscreen over the top of that scar gel and even using physical sun barriers such as sunglasses, hats, or if you can, keep the area completely covered with clothing. Clothing and sunglasses and hats are not perfect. They only filter part of the sun protection. So it's even better if you can even use sunscreen underneath those to filter even more. The less sun your new incision gets, the better. The second thing you can do at home to minimize the scarring and to maximize the final outcome is if you have a dark skin type like I do, once the stitches are out, once you have a healed incision, it can be helpful to use anti-pigment products. And the best anti-pigment product that I have are Koji Pads. They have kojic acid in them, which is a mushroom-derived chemical, believe it or not. And it does a fantastic job of controlling excess pigment production because in darker skin types, we tend to get post-inflammatory or post-traumatic hyperpigmentation. The scar heals dark. And so Koji Pads do a great job of controlling that. Also a mild cortisone. So the calming cream has a mild cortisone. Those do wonderful jobs. So what I would probably recommend in a dark skin type is swipe the Koji pad over it, a little bit of hydrocortisone, silicone gel twice a day. All that starts after the stitches are out and you have a clean healed incision line. The final thing around the 6 or 8 week mark, as things are going on, the scar is at its most active. So that is when technical interventions are helpful. Things like microneedling with platelet-rich plasma, things like pulsed dye lasers or intense pulsed light, things like dermabrasion, things like CO2 laser resurfacing. It's way too early to do those things at the 1 or 2 or 3 week mark. 6 or 8 weeks when the scar is in its proliferative phase and it's red and it's angry, that's the time to do it. And it's not super helpful at 2 or 3 years. The best window for that is 6 or 8 weeks is when to begin. The last thing we'll sometimes do for scars, if they're really bad, is consider a surgical scar revision. And a surgical scar revision is cutting out an ugly scar, but we this time get to control the injury. That's what was uncontrollable the first time. We can design it just right, make it with a sharp scalpel, put everything in our favor instead of the accidental way it was done the first time. Surgical scar revisions are generally indicated after the scar is fully mature. That's 1 or 2 years after the original injury. And we need to wait that long so the tissues are soft and healthy and can be manipulated delicately to get reclosed. If we do it in the first couple months when the tissues are stiff and angry, you're not going to get as beautiful of a scar. So with those, I hope those tips help you in managing your injury or surgery in the acute phase when you still have your stitches in the intermediate phase between stitches out and final result, and then if needed, when to consider a surgical scar revision. If you found that video helpful and want to learn more about how to look your best and age your best, smash that subscribe button, hit the notification bell, and give us a like.